Good morning, everyone. We've just had our Queensland Disaster Management Committee meeting, and I'll hand over to Matthew from the Bureau to give us an update on what is now still a severe weather system, which is travelling inland, but of course is going to affect coastal communities right down to the southeast, well into Friday. My main message today for residents on the Whitsunday coast is please stay off the roads. We need you to stay off the roads because at 9 o'clock this morning, the ADF will be doing a reconnaissance. They'll be looking at the structural damage which is happening on the Whitsunday coast, and we need to be able to get our emergency services personnel in as quickly as possible. I'll also get Commissioner Carroll to talk about the consequences if you are on the roads and flood levels are rising. I want to thank everyone for their patience. I want to thank the people of the Whitsunday coast for remaining indoors and going through what was a severe Category 4 system. We've had reports out of Collinsville that at this stage there are no injuries, and thankfully that is the case because Collinsville did receive Category 2 winds last night, and as people have been reporting, it was one of the most horrific nights of their life, and thankfully we're hearing that there have been no issues there. In terms of power, we have over 63,000 people without power at the moment. This is consistent with the number of people who lost power during Cyclone Marcia. In Mackay, we have 45% power loss, Serena 75%, and we also have loss of power in Moranbah as well, as those areas of Proserpine, Bowen and Ellie Beach. We also have isolated communities along the coast which have no phone contact at the moment, and of course we feel for those communities as well, and as part of the ADF satellite imaging, they will also be going in and trying to have a look at those small coastal communities as well. For many people this morning, they are waking up and they are seeing the devastation that has happened in their communities. Our hearts go out to them. There would be nothing more tragic than waking up and seeing walls that have come in from your houses, roofs that have gone off, and debris that is lying across your roads. Our priority is to look after you, is to look after the families that have been deeply impacted by this horrific cyclone. And that is why we are now moving into the recovery phase, and families come first. Everything we do now is for the families of the Whitsunday coast, the regions that have been impacted. We will have community recovery officers getting into these communities as quickly as possible. We will also be sending out public health safety messages when it comes to food and also water. So please listen to the authorities when they release those messages as well. I also want to thank the ambulance officers that have been tending to some incidents overnight. And on a bright note, it's lovely to see a little baby girl has been born overnight during this cyclone. And a big thank you to the doctor and the ambulance service officers that were on hand there for that delivery. In relation to health, we've got an extra 50 ambulance officers in the region ready to come in because, as I said, we just don't know yet if there are any other injuries, and our priority is, of course, to assist people as possible, and we'll be having an assistant commissioner stationed there to assist as well. All the hospitals will be open in the area, and if there are any emergencies, we will be sending people to their closest hospital, their normal hospital, so it should not be too traumatic for people. We're also sending 70 staff, health and nurses and doctors from Townsville down into Bowen and Proserpine to relieve staff that have been working very late overnight and into the morning. So our priority is to get resources on the ground. That is going to be the key. We've already seen some significant structural damage. We've been briefed on that by the State Disaster Coordinator, and those images are being aired across the televisions and across through social media. A lot of structural damage across that Whitsunday region. We're also prioritising getting water out to Daydream Island. We've got about 200 guests on that island and about 100 staff. That'll be a priority today as well. But power remains a big issue. And of course, the debris on the roads. We need to clear those roads, get our emergency personnel there. So please, families on the Whitsunday coast, we're getting there as quickly as possible. We need to get the ADF to do their job first and foremost, and we'll be with you as soon as possible. So I'll hand over to Matthew from the Bureau to give us an update on the weather system. We are going to also need people to stay off our roads as the weather system comes down inland and affects parts of our coast. That is very important. If you do not have to be on the roads until Friday, please stay off the roads. It's going to be some dangerous conditions, and I do want all Queenslanders to be safe. I'll hand over to Matthew.
Thank you, Premier.
Good morning. The tropical cyclone was downgraded to a tropical low at 3 a.m. overnight. Currently, it's located to the northwest of Moranbah and is continuing to track to the southwest this morning. During today, we expect the remnant low to begin a more southerly track and then take a southeasterly track during this evening. And that will bring the low down across southeastern Queensland during Thursday and Friday. And we're expecting the low to move off of the southeast Queensland coast during Friday morning, and that will clear the weather during Friday morning. However, in the meantime, we are still expecting very heavy rainfall, and we have issued a severe weather warning that's current for central parts of Queensland today. It's likely we will extend that warning further south into southeastern Queensland during this evening and into tomorrow. That warning is for heavy rainfall that will continue. We're looking at falls of 150 to 250 millimetres throughout the warning region today, with those falls continuing tomorrow as that low tracks down towards southeast Queensland. Those sorts of falls, we are anticipating some flooding issues as well, and we have a flood watch that now covers much of Queensland from Eyre to the New South Wales border, well inland to the Central Highlands and also inland to the Darling Downs as well. So there is a large area of the state that needs to be aware of flooding issues. Also in that warning, where we are warning for damaging wind gusts. We're expecting damaging wind gusts up to 120 kilometres per hour with this system as it tracks to the south. The wind gusts can be near the remaining low centre, and also particularly along the coastal strip will be quite exposed. So that zone of stronger winds will track with the low being inland along the coastal strip down towards the southeast over the next couple of days, and will move offshore during Friday morning as well with the clearance. The other thing to mention is on the coasts we will see large waves and some abnormally high tides. So people in coastal zones should be aware of that, and those large waves and high tides will continue down the coast with the low as it tracks to the south as well. So we'll leave it at that, but please be aware of all the warnings. I'd recommend you do go to the Bureau's website, www.bom.gov.au, and please keep up to date with all of the warnings. Thank you.
In terms of southeast Queensland, then, for a flood warning, what's the most crucial time?
So the heaviest rainfall for across the southeast Queensland area is likely to be overnight Thursday into Friday morning. So the rainfall should really pick up intensity across the southeast during Thursday afternoon. However, we are anticipating overnight Wednesday into Thursday and early Thursday morning, areas like the Darling Downs and the Burnett should also see heavy rainfall, as well as coastal zones up towards the Wide Bay.
Any estimated falls at this stage?
Estimated falls around about that 150 to 250 millimetres. It's likely that some of those really prone areas may see heavier totals. So prone areas, we're looking at the Gold Coast hinterland, Sunshine Coast hinterland, areas like that where you do get the terrain near the coast can ramp the rainfall up. But generally, we are looking at 150 to 250 millimetres.
Cyclone going to be, especially around that southern Gold Coast, northern New South Wales area?
Yeah, so the way the system is moving at the moment, the low is what's causing it to turn is actually the effects from systems in southern Australia at the moment. So that's actually causing it to turn and causing it to pick up speed and move down towards the southeast. So really the low will just be the main effect for us coming down. It's being steered a little bit by those southern systems, but it will just move down and push off the coast during Friday.
Yes, I can get Mark, Minister Bailey, to update us on the dams.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thanks, Matthew. Mark?
Sure. Look, we've had a very long, dry summer in southeast Queensland. So the Wivenhoe at the moment is at 67%, Somerset's at 74%, and North Pine's only at 51.5%. So we are in the strongest position we've been in for a number of years in terms of the flood capacity of our big dams in southeast Queensland.
So were any dams any water being released from dams at this stage in preparation for the
rain? Yeah, SecWater is doing some preemptive releases from Somerset into Wivenhoe at the moment. That's to level up the dams to maximise capacity. That's not likely to affect any residents in any way.
And what about south of Wivenhoe? Are any plans to release water from Wivenhoe at this stage?
No, there are no plans. Wivenhoe at 67% has got a large level of flood capacity available.
Premier, more of an overview, if you like. This, as you said, emergency services have been pains to point out, moves into a different phase. There's the recovery, obviously, that's going on, getting your emergency crews out there, but this flooding phase, how serious is it? And obviously, you want to avoid complacency with that as this system moves down.
Thanks, Carl, and that's a very good question, because that's right, we don't want any complacency, and that is why we're asking people to stay off our roads. What we are doing is we are looking at how much rainfall is coming into our catchments, and the modelling is happening extensively here at Kedron. We have some of the best experts in Australia looking at all of that, but my key message is to stay off the roads, because we will see some incidents of flash flooding. And once again, that is putting not just your life at risk, but the lives of SES workers. And I might just get Commissioner Carroll to talk briefly about swift water rescues and what that will mean if people venture out onto the roads with some of these rising floodwaters.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner, and good morning. Sorry, thank you, Premier, and good morning, everyone. As the Premier has said, look, it's dangerous really to be out in the roads at the moment. There is flash flooding and we're expecting more of that. We've already had two incidents this morning where we rescued someone in Proserpine who was caught in their vehicle in flooded waters, and my crews are going to a similar incident in Mackay. So this is the typical example of what occurs when we're out on those roads. This will continue in the next few days. So please, we've spoken about this for the last several days. We will continue to speak about this. If you don't have to be on the roads, please don't. The other thing it does, it actually clogs up that road system, so the first responders and the emergency workers cannot get to you in time. So there's already a lot of debris, there's a lot of trees, there's a lot of water. The situation is still quite dangerous out there, but please stay off the roads if you don't have to be on them.
Commissioner, do you have enough staff, enough resources to deal with what's happening in central and northern Queensland, as well as a flood emergency in southeast Queensland?
Yes, definitely. We've already planned for that and planning ahead. So we've asked assistance from New South Wales, from their Fire and Rescue and Rural Fire Service. I've got 56 staff coming up to assist us, particularly around the assessments that need to be done in that area. But certainly, Patrick, we've planned for that and are planning.
Any particular concerns about southeast Queensland in the next few days?
You know, my biggest concern is always around the swift water rescues that we know and plan for. And it's only a short time ago that five people died on one weekend in May because they were caught in floodwaters. So that's what we plan for. And that's why the messaging is always, always, if it's flooded, forget it and think about plan B.
Does anybody have any stats yet, or too early, on the number of homes which make up sustained damage?
We're just in the process of sectorising the streets, and we're starting that. The issue that everyone is having at the moment is around power and communications. So we're setting up our mobile cell on wheels so we can communicate with our staff. But certainly the comprehensive assessment of damage has been started in that area, and it will continue throughout the day.
We continue to see also very strong winds associated with this cyclone, the remnants of this cyclone. still going to be a danger, isn't it, even if it moves inland and tracks down the coast?
So what's hampering, obviously, the situation with the assessments and for rescuers to get out there is the rain and the water. And particularly, I'd like to comment at this stage that we have got well over 800 SES requests. That will increase dramatically when power comes back and communications come back and people start moving to their houses. Please be patient with us. We will get to you, but what will hamper us getting to you is the conditions out on the roads and the fact that there is still strong gusts and a lot of rain. Thank you.
Premier, insurance assessors are already on the ground heading into the area. What's your message to the insurance companies?
Look, very clearly, and the Treasurer spoke about this on our phone hookup just before. First of all, I want the assessors to treat people with respect. A lot of families are going to be waking up today shell-shocked about what they're seeing around them. We already are starting to, the insurance companies are already starting to mobilise and get their call centres set up. So a lot of work is going in making sure that they're on the ground and ready to talk to people. I want people to be respectful, and because a lot of people have lost their personal possessions, and this is going to be, you know, a really rough time for them in the coming days, if not weeks or months, as they start their rebuilding. Just in relation to Carl's question, he said before, we are still going to be seeing strong winds of up to 125 kilometres an hour. Now, what we are seeing, the tracking of this system is looking largely inland, but what we are going to see the effects of this system felt along the coastal communities as well, from Yeppoon southwards down to the southeast. We will see some beach closures, we will see large waves as well, and what we need to do is make sure, once again, that people take precautionary measures and don't go out into these conditions if they do not need to. This weather system is a huge weather system. It's come across the coast in northern Queensland and is going to come all the way down to the southeast, a huge system. So I need everyone to listen to the authorities. And like the Commissioner has said and the State Disaster Coordinator, if you do not need to be on the roads, do not be on the roads. So we're going to be updating people on a regular basis. We'll be continuing to have our Queensland Disaster Management Committee meetings. We'll have another one this evening, another one tomorrow morning. And as that system moves further down the coast, I'll also be making sure that the local mayors and the local disaster management committee meetings are also connected in so they get the most up-to-date information. Premier, I think communication here is the absolute key.
In terms of health and safety and yes. the areas that are worst hit, what are you doing to put food and water into those places?
Yes, so we've already sent a lot of food up through the freight through our freight network before the weather system hit. So we do have supplies ready to go into IGA and Woolworths. However, what we do know is because of the power has been out, it is going to be unsafe to eat some of the food that is currently there. So Dr. Jeanette Young, our Chief Medical Officer, will be putting out some information to people over the next few hours, and we'll be communicating that to families as quickly as possible.
Talking about power, are there any predictions yet as to how long we'll be before we start seeing supply restored?
I might get Minister Bailey to talk a bit more about that, but we do have a large number of homes that are deeply impacted. And as we saw, this is about the same number with Cyclone Marcia. So it is going to take a lot of time and a lot of effort. People could be without power up to a week or even over a week. Some places will be able to be restored quickly. We do not know that at this stage until we get the assessments in. Mark?
Yeah, look, we've got more than 820 power workers from right across the state, pre-deployed both north and south of the impact zone and also in the impact zone. What will happen, though, based on previous cyclones, is the assessments need to be made, and what power workers are dealing with is water across roads. The Bruce Highway is cut in three places, just north of Bowen, at Airlie Beach and also south of Mackay. In some places you've got large trees wrapped up in live wires, so that work has to be done safely, and we've got to be able to get access into areas before we can get power back on. We can't put our power workers at risk either. So that's so what we'll see probably in the next day or two is that we might not get a lot of progress on the power front until we can safely get that work done.
A week's going to be unfathomable for a lot of those people out there, given what they've been through, the torment they've been through with the system, and how long they've already been without power.
Look, we will be doing this work as quickly as we possibly can. This has been the best preparation that we've ever seen for a cyclone. The pre-deployments are unprecedented, so they are close to they are closer to the action than they've ever been. They're raring to go, and we will get this work done as quickly as we can. But I can say for the first day or two, just simply getting access in there is difficult when you've got waters across roads, you've got floodwaters to deal with. That's going to be the issue. So we'll get through this work as quickly as we can as those assessments are done. But, you know, it'll just depend. It'll be a day-by-day progress.
Just to be accurate, what are we defining as the impact zone? Is it Melbourne to Mackay, Eyre to Mackay?
Yeah, good morning. Obviously, it's been a large area that's been impacted, but the really severe area is that area around Bowen, Whitsunday, Proserpine. Those areas and the Whitsunday Islands remain difficult for us to contact and to get into. We're progressively getting information out of there. I'm pleased to say that the information we're getting out of there, that whilst there's a significant damage, there are no injured people. For instance, all the people on Daydream Island, significant damage, but everyone is safe. So we'll work through that, make sure that the people are safe, and then we'll get the damage stuff done. So that area there is the area of most focus. In Collinsville too, of course, we're looking at that.
Do you have any rough idea what the population of that part of
Well, if you look at Mackay, is it just over 100,000? Around that area, we're probably talking with Collinsville around 25,000 or so.
Steve, one of the islands is running out of water. I can't recall which one.
Daydream.
Where of that?
They're trying to get people off the island. Can you update us?
Yes, our water police is already engaged for a number of tasks up that way. They're constrained by the environment. Air travel is constrained by the environment. We're constantly monitoring that. As the day goes on, working with our partner agencies, including the ADF, we'll look at how we can get assets in there
so
to try and help people.
Try and get them off?
We'll look at that on a priority basis. Depends on their safety and their needs at the moment. Patrick, we've got a big area of people that we have to consider. We'll have to triage in terms of where we need to go. We're fortunate in that we have resources in that area already, and we're looking at getting more resources in today.
You mentioned that there's been no injuries as of yet. Are you still expecting fatalities and further injuries?
We have to be very careful with this because we have up to half of our power network out. That means we can't contact everyone. We simply don't know what the extent of this is. We're very encouraged by the fact that, for instance, Bowen isn't as bad as we thought it would be. Significant damage, not the destruction that we feared, and certainly no reports of people seriously injured out of those areas. As the day unfolds, we'll get real clarity around this.
And any update on the condition of the gentleman that was injured yesterday with the wall collapse?
Yes, we understand he is stable. Yes.
What about the two that were on a vessel that ran aground?
Yes, I can talk to you about that. We're in contact with them. Water police have started their operation to try and retrieve them. They're safe. They have power, they're well provisioned, we'll get to them.
Do you have any dramas of wounding or anything like that, any warning for people like that?
We're pretty experienced at this, Carl. We're pushing our resources forward very quickly to make sure that the community is not only safe, but it's also secure.
Premier, do you have any plans yourself to head up today?
Look, later on this morning, I hope to be meeting with Brigadier Chris Field to talk about the Australian Defence Force operations, so I'm looking forward to meeting with him in Townsville in the next few hours.
Will you go to the zones?
I will only go to the zones when it is safe to do so, and at the with the clear indication from the Australian Defence Force that is okay and safe for me to do so. So I would like to get on the ground as quickly as possible to see how the communities are. A lot of families are going to be going through their worst nightmare, and I just want to reassure them that all of Queensland is with them. We have postponed our meetings of the Gold Coast for governing from the Gold Coast for next week. That is the right thing to do. I expect all of my ministers to be focused on the recovery efforts, and as you have just heard, this weather system is going to be continuing for the rest of this week, and I need everyone focused on this.
You've got your family up there too, you've got members of your family up there, and it's taken a toll on a lot of people across the broad area.
Look, absolutely. My brother-in-law, he was raised in Bowen with his family. His father was the local high school teacher up there. They moved with family up to Townsville during this weather event. Hopefully their house is okay, but it has had a deep impact on a lot of people living in that region. And as people in regional Queensland know, they always back each other. They're always there for each other, and now is the time for neighbours to help neighbours.
Steve, do you have any details of people trapped in a house at
Eaton in Mackay? Not specifically, Patrick, but can I say that we had a number of reports of roofs off with people still ill through the event. All of those have been accounted for at this stage, subject to our ability to get into the field, but not specifically about that.
Okay. Commissioner, do you want to say anything just in closing?
No, thank you, Premier. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been an extraordinary weather event, but the key message today is that it's not over. Yes, we are starting that transition from response into recovery, and we're very, very grateful for the cooperation of the community. But this next phase is just as important and can be just as dangerous as we start to do the assessments, that we start to get into some of those communities that have been isolated. We know, for instance, that there are still a number of communities in that main damage area that have no access to communication. So, and that includes 000. So our priority will be to ensure that we get into those areas first, and we do as much as we can to ensure their safety. There are calls that will come in, and we've already heard about the swift water rescues that are taking place. There are calls coming in where people will make a choice about going out on the roads, about doing other things that are perhaps not the best decision. And those avoidable events are ones that soak up the resources of emergency services. Those emergency services need to be out there focusing primarily on the assessments, making sure that the small communities and those isolated communities are safe. So I truly ask the public, have patience, work with your neighbours, don't go out if you don't have to, because at the end of the day, we need to keep everyone safe. We've been, I think, extraordinarily fortunate right to this point in time in this event. We need to keep it that way as this whole big system moves now out into central Queensland and down the coastal areas. We've got a long way to go yet. We need your cooperation. We need you to heed the warnings that are coming from your officials, from the government, and from the agencies that are most concerned with the planning now that will go forward with this very significant rain event. And remember, wind gusts are above 100 kilometres an hour, are basically Category 1 cyclone winds. And even though it's not a cyclone anymore, it is still quite destructive. We need people to understand that. And work with us to keep the entire Queensland safe. Thanks.
Can I just clarify the attitude to day group evacuation? Did I understand you saying that will only happen, A, if you think it's necessary, and B, if you think it's...
No, sorry. It's whether we can. So yes. Can we actually get there? So we have to put that into it. And then we have to look at the priority of everyone that has to be evacuated. So definitely people will be evacuated.
So you want to.
Yes, and that planning's happening today, and we'll work through it.
Commissioner Stewart, you have 390 police on standby to get into the areas. Will they still be deployed?
Absolutely, when it's safe to do so, Patrick, and that's a really important point, because we are still seeing significant road closures. The Bruce Highway, for instance, is cut north of Bowen, south of Proserpine. These are very, very critical times for us. Obviously, with the help of other agencies, particularly the ADF, we can airlift people in. But again, this is a fine balance between using up resources locally and doing the job. And that's why it's so important for people to think of their neighbours, their loved ones in their local area, to help them out when they can, but certainly not to go out on the roads unless it's absolutely critical in that area that's been devastated by this cyclone.
And just in terms of the scope of what's unfolding, you've got what's happening in central Queensland with Cyclone Debbie and the southeast. resources are going to be stretched enormously over the next week or so.
They are, but like every emergency services, Patrick, we've planned for this. We're ready for it. We have our contingencies in place. Core business is important right across the state, but at the same time, we've got to manage that critical threat to our community, and we take that very seriously.
Thanks, everyone. Just in closing, can I thank all of our emergency services personnel? They are outstanding Queenslanders. They have your best interests at heart. They are working night and day. And honestly, I couldn't ask for a finer bunch of men and women to work with. Thank you.